Good morning, everyone. Today, I'm just going to talk to you about the training and development. As you know that when we are giving the training to the employees who are recently joining the company or who are already working in the company, there is one thing which is very, very important when we are giving training to the people. As you must be aware about this thing, then training and development is one of the most integral and important part of the organization, because without training it is difficult for the people who are working in the organization to understand the process as well as the new innovative ideas and that new technologies which are coming up on day-to-day basis. So training is must for each and every organization to enhance the knowledge of the employees as well as to give proper training to the employees on a certain aspects which are required in the organization. So when we are going to talk about the training and the development programs are concerned, it is usually come into the mind of the people that what are the outcome of that? That whenever we are giving the training to the people, we identify what are the evaluations what we are doing after giving the training to the people, that what are the basic outcome. So in this regard, this session is going to delivered regarding the outcome used in the evaluation of the trainings, the hierarchical nature of Kirkpatrick's framework. That means, as I have already discussed this thing, Kirkpatrick is the scientist who has given different, you know, module regarding the training programs. So according to him, that higher level outcome should not be measured unless positive changes occur in lower level outcome. This is what Kirkpatrick said, that according to Kirkpatrick, he's saying that the outcome at the higher level should not be measured. That means it cannot be measured until and unless the changes are occurring at the lower level. And what are the outcomes of that? Because they are saying that it is very, very important to see that whatever the changes are taking place and whatever the outcomes are coming at the lower level, then only the higher level outcomes can be measured in a proper manner. That means if the training is given to the lower level people, definitely the outcome will be much more better for the higher level people. The framework implies that changes at a higher level are more beneficial than changes at the lower level. They are saying, according to the Kirkpatrick, that the changes at the higher level are much more beneficial to the organization rather than the lower level. So they are saying, in one point, they are saying that if there are changes at the lower level regarding the outcomes are concerned, then only it is affecting the higher level changes also, and it can be measured. On the other hand, he's saying that if changes are occurring at the higher level, it is much more better than the changes in at the lower level. That means when the changes are there after taking the training and development programs, it is usually seen that whatever the changes are coming at the higher level, they can, you know, cascade those training programs or those module to the lower level also, and they will also imply the same thing. Then Kirkpatrick framework criticism. What are the basic criticisms this Kirkpatrick framework received? Research has now found that each level is caused by the level that precedes it in the framework, nor does evidence suggest that the level differ in importance. That means there are criticisms on Kirkpatrick model also. They are saying that it is found that each level is caused by the level that precedes it in the framework, or nor any evidence suggested that the level differ is important. But according to this, they are saying that the whatever the level differences are there, it is important. The approach does not take into account the purpose of the evaluation. They are saying that whatever the approach Kirkpatrick has taken, it is not, you know, giving any purpose to the evaluation process. Then outcome can and should be collected in an orderly manner. That is measure of reaction, followed by measure of learning behavior and the results. They are saying that whatever the outcomes are coming after the training and development program, it is usually said that it should come in a proper orderly manner. That means measure of reaction, that what are the reactions of those trainees who have taken the training, then followed by the measure of learning, that how you are measuring the learning process of those trainees, that how much they have learned in that. And then the behavior changes, that how their behavior changes and the results of that particular training program. So they are saying that it should be an orderly process which consists of reaction, learning, behavior and the results. So remember one thing, whenever there is a question comes that what are the basic criticisms of Kirkpatrick model, you have to say that it should be in the orderly manner, which is related with the reaction, related with the learning behavior and the results of the outcome. And it cannot, you know, solve the purpose of evaluation also. This is also one of the criticisms of the Kirkpatrick model. Then there are different type of evaluation outcomes which are given here. It is related with the reactions, learning or cognitive processes, effectiveness, results, company results, return on investments. So if you see this thing, we talk about the reaction. It is level one. That means what is measured? Learner's satisfaction. What learners have satisfied, what learners have learned. Then example is comfortable training room, useful material and problem contents, and the method of measurement is survey. We have to just do the survey, and on the basis of that we can find out that what exactly outcome comes, and basic of the interviews also. Then learning or cognitive, it is level two, in which we are going to talk about the principles, facts, techniques, procedures. That means these are the things which are going to be measured, learning or cognitive process. Then examples, we can say electrical principles, safety rules, steps in interviewing. This can be measured with the method of test and work samples. Then behavior and skill, this is level 2 and 3. In this, we have to talk about the technical or motor skills of behavior. Then example we can take is preparing a desert, sawing wood, learning, landing on airplane, listening. And method of measurement are test, observation, self, peer, customers, etc. Then what is effective? This is also second and third level, in which what is measured? Learner's attitude and motivation. Then how they are going to be motivated and learn the things. Then examples are tolerance, diversity, safety, attitude and customer services. Then what are the method of measurement? Attitude survey, interviews and focus groups. Then results, this is level 4. In this we have to say the payoff for the company. We are measuring those things. Then examples we can say productivity, quality, cost, repeat. Then what are the methods of measurement? Observation, performance data from records or customers database. Then return on investment, this is level 5. Identification and comparison of learning benefits with the cost, that whatever the cost we have incurred during the training program, and what are the learning trainees have received after going for the training program. So we can take the example of the dollar or rupees value of the productivity provided by the training cost. Then the economic value, this is the method of measurement. So these are the evaluation outcomes which we have to think over it. So you have to remember only a few things. Number one is the outcome, reaction, what are criteria, learning or cognitive process, behavior and skill, effectiveness, results, company and return on investment. Then what are the reaction outcomes? It is collected at the program's conclusion. That means that whatever the program given to the employees. So it is collected from each and every trainees, and it is the conclusion of that particular program, that whether it is good or medium or fair. Then cognitive outcomes, they do not help to determine if the trainee will actually use decision making skills on the job. So they are saying, when we talk about the cognitive or learning outcomes, they say that it will not help to determine if the trainees are actually using the decision making process or skills. Then skill based outcome, the extent to which trainees have learned skills can be evaluated by observing their performance in work samples such as simulators. That means, you know, when we are talking about the training program, there are different type of training. As I have told you, there is one sort of training which is known as simulation. So they are saying that in this, we have to skill based outcome, we have to see that how learned skills can be evaluated by observing the performance of the trainee in the work samples as well as such as simulator. That means when we are putting up the thing in simulation, that means we are giving them a practical aspects of the actual work which they are going to do in the organization. So what are the basic outcome of that, and which type of performance in the work samples they are doing it. Then return on investment, direct cost, salaries and benefits for all employees involving in training program, material and supplies, equipment or classroom rentals or purchases and travel costs. So a return on investment can be calculated, that what are the benefits and salaries are giving to the employees who are involved in the training. Then program, material and supplies, then what we are providing to the trainees, then the equipments or the classroom which we are using it, or the travel cost. Then indirect cost includes, it is not related directly to the design, development or delivery of the training program. Then what are the benefits, value that the company gains from the training program? That means that whatever the training they have given to the trainees, these trainings are putting up the same training in practical in the organization, and by means of which organization's productivity increases. So this is the basic benefit of the training program. So that's why it is said that it is important for the organization to do the training, so that the people will work more effectively and they are well versed with the latest training modules, etc. Then when determining whether outcomes are appropriate or not, as we were talking about the outcomes of the training program, that what are the basic training evaluation outcomes. Now we are going to talk about whether outcomes are appropriate or not. So if we talk about the criteria relevance, this says the extent to which training outcomes are related to the learned capability emphasized in the training program. That means this is the extent of the training outcome, that which type of training they have given to the trainees and what are the capabilities or the learning process they have adopted. That means I'm talking about the trainees in the training program. Then criteria contamination, the extent that training outcome measures inappropriate capabilities or are affected by the extraneous condition. Criteria contamination means that whenever you are giving the training to the people or the trainees, sometimes it happens that whatever the training you have given, but you are measuring the outcomes and it shows that it is inappropriate capabilities are there who are taking the training. Or there are extraneous conditions which are going to hamper the training program and employees are not able to understand those things. So this is another criteria contamination. Then criteria deficiency, the failure to measure training outcomes that were emphasized in the training objective. That means whatever the objectives we have decided regarding the training is concerned. I will like to tell you one thing, that when we are talking about the objectives of the training, these objectives of the trainings are directly related with the objective of the organization also. So here we are saying that it is when we are not able to measure the training outcomes that were emphasized in the training objectives, then it is criteria deficiency. That means that whatever the objectives are there, and during the training we are not emphasizing on those particular objectives, you can very well understand that it is a deficiency on the part of the training department. Then reliability, the degree to which outcomes can be measured consistently over time. That means that reliability means that during the training program, when you are measuring the outcomes, it can be easily measured and it is consistent throughout the training program. So it is the reliability, which is known as reliability, that if it is consistent throughout the training program, it is reliability. Then discrimination, the degree to which trainees' performance on the outcome actually reflects true differences in the performances. That means that whatever the training given to the trainees and the performance on the outcome actually reflects the true differences in the performance. That means that whatever the performance is expected from the trainees, those are not present there while these trainees are taking the training program. So this is a discrimination, that actual performance cannot be measured when trainings are given to the people. Then practicality, the ease with which the outcome measures can be collected. Practicality means that whatever the things which you are collecting after giving the training to the employees, it is easily collected and it can be measured easily. So these are the appropriate outcome. So remember one thing, if any question arises in the mind of anyone and they would like to talk to you, that if we are talking about the outcome of the evaluation of the training, so whether the outcomes are appropriate or not. So it is divided into four parts. Number one is the criteria relevance, which is divided into two parts. That is criteria contamination and criteria deficiency. Then second is reliability. Third is discrimination. And fourth is practicality. Now, I have given a figure here that criteria deficiency, relevance and contamination, how they are going to be affected. Outcomes measured in evaluation. That means that whatever the measurements can be taken when we are evaluating the whole training program, what are the outcomes of that? Then outcome related to the training objective. This is another point which is related with relevance. That means that whatever the training we have given and whatever the training objectives are there, how it is going to relate to the training objective. That means that whatever the training we are giving to the trainees, whether they are directly related with the outcomes. Then outcomes identified by need assessment and including in training objective, which is known as deficiency. So whatever I have explained to you just now, it is in the diagrammatic form, that we have to see the outcome by need assessments. And we have to see that how these need assessments are related with the training objectives of the organization. Then what are the training objectives and the implication for evaluation? So first of all is the objective. As I have told you, that it is very, very important that objective should be given to the learner and it can be transferred into different forms. So here I've given a small breakup here. So if we talk about the outcomes, first of all is the reactions. Did trainee like the program? Did the environment help the learning? Was material meaningful? These are the three questions which comes into the mind of the evaluation process people, that whether the training program which is given to the trainees are up to the mark and the trainees like the program, or whether the environment in which they are taking their training, it is conducive for them, or whether the material which are provided to them are meaningful. Then second is learning and cognitive, pencil and paper tests, whether we are giving pencil and paper tests to them. Then behavior skill based. performance on a work sample. That means that we will give some samples and we have asked the, you know, trainees to work on that. So this is known as behavior skill. That means that whatever you have understood, you have to put up your skill into that. Then again, in behavior skill, rating by peers or managers based on observation of behavior. That means that this behavior skill is measured by the peers, by the managers, and it is totally based on the observation of the behavior, that what are the behavior changes are taking place after getting that training. It is very, very important. Then effectiveness, trainees motivation or job attitude. That means if you are giving a training to the people, whether they are fully motivated and what are the attitude of those people towards their jobs. Then next is the results. Did company benefit through sales, quality, productivity, reduced accidents and the complaints? That means that it is very, very important to understand this thing, that when we are giving the training to the people and we are talking about the reaction, cognitive process, skill-based behavior changes, then effectiveness, we have to find out the results also, whether the company is going to benefit after giving the training to the trainees, and whether the quality and the productivity of the organization is going to be increased, and whether the accidents are going to be reduced and complaints are also reduced. So these are the things which we have to talk about the training objective and implication for evaluation, that there are something which has to be taken into consideration, that whether after giving the training, whether objectives are met properly and what are the outcome of that, what are the implications which has to be evolved. Then when we are talking about the training program, we are talking about the evaluation program, we are talking about other things. Now we are going to talk about the evaluation designing. Threat to validity. Factors that will lead an evaluator to question either the internal validity, the believability of the study results. Then external validity means the extent to which the evaluation results are generalized to other group of trainees and situation. That means there are two things which comes under the validity. Number one is internal validity, the believability of the study result. That means whether the results which we have produced after giving the whole training program, whether it is believable or not. Second is external validity. This says that the extent to which the evaluation results are generalized to other group of trainees and situation. That means whatever the evaluation results are coming, whether it is generalized or to other groups and the trainees also. Then there is a chart which shows you the threat to validity. It is divided into two parts. Number one is the company, number two is the description. If we talk about the company, this is denoted by the history. Description means events training, maturation. That means changes in training outcomes, results from trainees' physical growth or emotional state, moral mortality means study participation, dropped out of study, and initial group differences means training group differs from comparison group on individual differences. Then what are the outcome measurements? Testing. Trainees are sensitized to perform well. Instrumentation. Trainees' interpretation of outcome changes over course of evaluation. Then regression toward the means. That means high and low scoring trainees move toward middle or average on post-training measurement. Then threat to the external validity. Reaction to the pretext. Use of texts before training causes trainees to pay attention to material or test. Then reaction to evaluation, interaction of selection and training, and last is the interaction of the methods. So if we talk about the evaluation design, the methods you control for threats to validity, it is pre-test and post-test. A comparison of the post-training and pre-training measures can indicate the degree to which trainees have changed as a result of training. Yes, it is very, very important to see when you're going to give the training to the employees or the trainees. You have to do the pre and post training measurements. You have to identify the pre-test. You have to take the pre-test and the post-test. On the basis of that, you have to do the comparison. On the basis of this comparison, you can identify whether the trainee has changed as a result of the training or they still need some other things also. Then random assignments, assigning employees to the training or comparison group on the basis of the chance. It helps to reduce the effect of employees dropping out of the study. And differences between the training group and comparison group is ability, knowledge, skill, or other personal characteristics will take place. That means random assignment means you have to assign the employees to the training or comparison group on the basis of chances. That means that you are going to take the chances, and on the basis of that, you are randomly assigning the employees or the group of employees for the training period. It will affect the best part, which is known as it will reduce the employees dropping out of the study, and it will compare the ability, knowledge, skill, or other personal characteristics of that individual. Then methods to control for threat to validity. They are giving some methods also, which is saying that using a comparison group, employees who participate in the evaluation study but do not attend the training program helps to rule out the possibility that changes found in the outcome measures are due to factor other than training. So in comparison group, what they are doing, they are talking about the employees who are not taking the training, but they are a member of the evaluation team, and that it will help rule out the possibilities that changes found in the outcome measurements are due to factors other than the training programs. Then there is another chart. You can just go through this chart and you can see that how we have, you know, put up the comparison of evaluation designing, on which basis we are putting up the evaluation, on which group we are doing it, pre-training, post-training, cost, time, and if trend. This is the chart which maybe you can just go through it and you can find out that how it is beneficial. Then types of evaluation designing. Number one is time series. Training outcomes are collected at periodic intervals, both before and after the training. They are saying it is very, very important when we are giving the training to the employees, and whatever the training outcomes are collected, it should be in periodic intervals before as well as the after of the training also. So you will get an idea about it, that what is the consistencies of the training which is taking place. Is there anything which has to be modified, or is there anything which has to be reduced from there? Then it allows an analysis of the stability of training outcome over time. That means that what I have said just now, that when you are taking the periodical intervals training outcomes pre and post, and on the basis of that, when you are doing the analysis, you can easily find out whether the stability of the training is absolutely correct over the time period or it has to be changed. Then reversal. Time period in which participants no longer receive the training intervention. Reversal means that it is a time period in which participants are no longer receiving the training intervention. That means they are not going for the training interventions of that day. Then what are the factors that influence the type of evaluation design? So here I am going to talk about the factors which are really influencing the evaluation designing. Number one is change potential. How the factor influence the type of evaluation designing? It says that can the program be modified? Does ineffective training affect customer service, product development, or relationship among employees? You should understand this thing that when the training are giving to the people, if the training is appropriate and good, it will reflect in the customer's sales also, customer services also, then it will give a more quality and productive thing for the organization, or it will create a relationship between the employees. So it becomes a very nice environment in the organization, and people would like to work in that. Then scale, how many trainees are involved? That means how many trainees are involved, whether 5 trainees are there, 20 there, 50 or 100 trainees are there. Then purpose of the training, is training conducted for learning results or both? Then organizational culture, is demonstrating results part of company's norms and expectations? That means that whatever the trainings are given, whether it is related with the company's norms and the procedures or expectations. Then expertise, can a complex study be analyzed? Because sometimes it happens in the big organization, sometimes it becomes so difficult for move forward to complete the work. So there are some complex situations which has to be analyzed during the training program also. Then cost, is evaluation too expensive? Then time frame, when is the information needed? That means that when you are giving the training to the people, you have to see that when you are going to get the information. Then next point which we are talking about, the cost benefit analysis. That means return on investment. Process of determining the economic benefits of a training program using accounting methods that look at training costs and benefit. That means that whatever the economic benefits we are looking for the organization during the training program, it is analyzed with the help of the cost and benefit analysis, that whatever the cost we are incurring during the training program and what are the outcome of those training program, that what benefit the organization is going to get after the training program. Then return on investment should be limited only to certain training program because it can be costly. So here they are saying that return on investment is limited to certain programs, not for each and every program, because it is a costly work. Then how you are going to determining the cost? Method for comparison costs of alternative training programs, including the resource requirements, model, and accounting. That means when we are talking about the determining the cost, we have to see this thing that what are the methods which we are using for comparing the cost of alternative training programs. That means that whatever the cost we are going to occur in our training program, we have to see the alternative training methods also, which is the related, which is directly related with the resource requirements, model, and accounting. Then determining the benefits method, it includes the technical, academic, and practitioner literature. That means that whatever the things you are providing to the trainees during the training program, whether it is technical, whether it is academic, or whether it is practitioner literature, it is a benefit. Then pilot training program and observance of successful job performance. That means you have to see that what training programs are initially giving, so which is known as the pilot training program, and on the basis of which you have to see the observation of the successful job performance. Then estimates by trainees and their manager. Then we have to find out the estimate of the trainees and the managers, because these people are involved into this. So how much money we are involving into this, that is also another point which we have to take into consideration. Then to calculate return on investment, it divide by benefit by cost. The ROI gives an estimate of the dollar or rupee return expected from each rupee or dollar invested in the training. That means that when we are calculating the return on investment, we have to divide the benefit by cost. so that we will find out the return expected from each rupee or dollar we have invested on each and every employee during the training program. Then this is an example of cost benefit analysis which I have just given here just for the reference. Then utility analysis, when we are talking about the return on investment and when we are talking about the different costs, another analysis which are usually taking place, it is known as utility analysis. A cost benefit analysis method that involves assessing the dollar or rupee value of training. That means we are assessing the value of training related with the dollar or rupees. Number one is the estimates of the difference in job performance between trained and untrained employees. We have to see that what are the estimate of the difference of the jobs. That means the trained employees and the untrained employees. What are the basic investment which we are giving, going to have on them? We have to differentiate those things. The number of individuals trained, then we have to calculate that how many people we have trained. The length of time a training program is expected to influence the performance. That means that it is also necessary to understand this thing, that what is the time period, what is the duration of the whole training program which can influence the performance of the people. Because sometimes it happens that company says that okay, we are giving you half day training, 1 day training. Some company says no, we will give you 7 days training. Some people will say that okay, no, we will give you 5 days training. So we have to see that how much duration we have to put up on our trainees to find out that what are the influence of taking place on as per the performance is concerned. That means that whatever the training you are giving, whether it is affecting the performance of the individual or not, that is one thing. Then the variability in job performance in the untrained group of employees. In the untrained employees group, as I have told you just now, that we have to see the differences of job performances between the trained and the untrained employees. Here also the same thing is there, that they are saying that whatever the variables are occurring in the untrained group of employees has to be measured, analyzed, and on the basis of that we have to find out the cost and benefit analysis for that. So it is another point which we have to talk about it. So there are two type of analysis which we have to see when we are talking about the return on investment. Number one is the cost and benefit analysis, and second is the utility analysis. Then what are the training metrics? Expenditure per employee, this is first point. Learning hours received per employees, second point. Expenditure as a percentage of payroll, that as per the payroll, how much expenditure you are giving or putting up on the employee. Expenditure as a percentage of revenue. Then cost per learning hour received. Percentage of expenditures for external services. That means if we are calling some resource person, or if we are taking some, you know, training rooms outside the organization, whatever expenditure we are giving, we have to take into consideration. Then learning hours received per training and development staff member. Then average percentage of learning activities outsourced. Average percentage of learning content by content area. That means skill, customer service, executive development, etc. And the average percentage of learning hours provided via different delivery methods. That means instructor-led, technological-based. So these are the basic training metrics which we have to keep in mind, that when we are talking about the training and development evaluation, we have to understand that what are the basic metrics regarding the training is concerned. That means expenditure, learning hours, expenditure, payroll, revenue, cost per learning hours, average percentage of learning activities, percentage of learning contents. average percentage of learning hours joined, provided different delivery methods, etc. So these are the basic things which we are going to put up in front of anyone who are going to ask you any question regarding the training outcome of the training evaluation methods. So we can talk about this. Then last we can talk about the utility analysis. So on the basis of that, I have just put up some questions here, and I think you are easily attempt this question. I will just read out this question for your benefit. The following are the benefit of training: increased productivity, reduced accidents, reduced supervision, and all of the above. I think you are in a position to give the answer for this. Then the following training aims to provide broad training to enable the trainees to wake up a wide variety of tasks within his field of his specialization: demonstration, on the job training, apprenticeship, all the above. Then demonstration type of training method is used to train the workers, supervision, managers, all of the above. Then next question comes: the following is not a part of the lower level management: worker, foreman, supervisor, and the inspector. A homogeneous group of, fill in the blank, men from the plant constitutes an ideal conference group: 8 to 10, 12 to 15, 18 to 20, 22 to 25. I'm quite sure that you are in a position to give the answer. This question related to the things which we have just gone through it. Then next question comes: the following method is used to give to trainees the important information in permanent form for immediate or future use: lecture methods, conference, instructional methods. Then another question comes: training within the industry scheme impart training in job instructions, job rotation methods, all of the above. Then another question: the following is not a job rotation management by objective or case study. Then following is vertical expansion of the job: job rotation, enrichment, management by objective, all of the above. And the last question says, fill in the blank, is widely used for human relations and leadership training: business games, role play, case study method, and job rotation. So these are the questions which I have just given to you, so that you are in a position to give the answer of these questions after giving a thought process. What I have told you, that it is related with the evaluation process, and it is a common questions which I have asked, and I'm quite sure that you are in a position to give the answer for these questions very effectively. So in this session, I have described to you regarding the job evaluation and outcome of that, and how it can be taken care by, then what are the Kirkpatrick submission regarding his research is concerned, and what are the criticism he faced. Then we have talked about the different type of I've given you some chart regarding the criteria are correct. Concern, then there are few things which is related with the factors are concerned. Then what are these outcomes? So it is important to understand this thing very effectively, and I'm quite sure that you, after going through this lecture, you are in a position to describe the thing and discuss the thing with anyone who want to get an insight about the evaluation outcome of the evaluation process. So these are the things which comes into training program, and it is one of the most important part of the training program, because whatever the trainings are given by the organization, it has to be seen that I have emphasized on one thing, that they mean the training objectives, because I have told you this thing, that training objectives are directly related with the objective of the organization. So it has to be seen that whatever the training are given to the employees, in return, these employees are going to work on their practical things, on the job training, and by means of which the productivity of the organization increases, as well as the profitability of the organization also increases. So it is very, very important for any organization to identify the people to whom they have to give the training. And training is must for each and every organization for enhancing the knowledge regarding the latest technological changes are concerned, as well as some other issues are there. And on the basis of that, you have to evaluate the things. And if the evaluation is absolutely right, you will find out that the people are going to benefit by that, as well as the organization are also going to benefit by that. So this is all from my side. Thank you very much.